The final article in the GI section that I'll talk about is this article here that talked about different types of calcium within the pancreas and if we could use certain patterns to tell between benign and malignant lesions. So here we can see their overall chart summary, which is very good because it breaks these down into the different types of lesions, as well as the overall incidence, how common they are, the pattern of calcification that can be identified, as well as any notes that can be helpful in trying to identify these lesions. And we'll see some examples of this. We can see two patients that had chronic pancreatitis. The one on the left we can see has duct dilatation, several calcifications that are present within the duct itself, as well as low density of the pancreatic parenchyma proximally. This patient on the right had a pseudocyst due to chronic pancreatitis, and we can see that there's a very low density lesion within the pancreas that has peripheral calcification. Here's a patient that had cystic fibrosis and some associated changes within the pancreas. We can see on the lung windows of the CT that there is bronchiectasis. And then on the CT within the upper abdomen, we can see that there's several cysts in the pancreas, cystosis, as well as several calcifications. And we can contrast that appearance with these that are neoplastic. So on the left-hand side, we have an IPMN. And in this case, we can see that there is dilation of the main duct at the tail, as well as several calcifications that are present within the duct itself. And then on the right, we have a mucinous neoplasm that appears as a low-density mass with septal calcifications. So the take-home points for this article is that calcium within the pancreas typically occur within chronic pancreatitis, but that there are several other entities that are benign and malignant that should prompt evaluation whenever we see this on imaging. Moving on to GI, the first article that I'm going to talk about is this article that looked at renal neoplasms and cysts on contrast-enhanced CT to try and identify features that could be used to distinguish between these two. So they looked at a wide variety of lesions, including renal cysts, but also some RCCs that were homogeneous, as well as those that were heterogeneous. And what they actually found is that there was a significant difference in several features, including the overall size of the lesion, as well as the HU on the contrast-enhanced study. So we can see that the RCCs that were more heterogeneous tended to be larger than those that were homogeneous, as well as cysts, and that there was a big difference in the enhancement and the overall density of RCCs in general compared to cysts. So here we have two examples here. On the left, we have a renal cell carcinoma that was homogeneous that showed HU of 58. And then on the right, we have a renal cyst that was also homogeneous but had a much lower HU of 25. So the take-home points for this study is that they found that simple cysts that were homogeneous tended to have low attenuation on contrast-enhanced CT up to 30, but never above 30. And that some of the renal cell carcinomas that were homogeneous tended to have mean attenuation values as low as 42, but that there was no overlap between the homogeneous renal cysts and the homogeneous RCCs. The next article is this, which discusses PIRADS version 2 with regards to the patients that had a Gleason score of 3 plus 4 equals 7 diagnosed at biopsy. So in this study, they looked at 81 men that had prostate cancer and Gleason score of 3 plus 4 equals 7 diagnosed on transrectal ultrasound biopsy. They underwent MRI as well as prostatectomy. For each of the MRI, the MRI exams, they used PIRADS version 2 to evaluate them. And they compared these scores with several features, such as the location of the tumor, the Gleason score, as well as the presence of EPE at radical prostatectomy. And so here we can see some of the results. We can see that overall, the PIRADS assessment category increased with the degree of pathology. So we can see that those that had a Gleason score of 4 plus 3 equals 7 had a much higher PIRADS score than those that had 3 plus 4 equals 7 or 3 plus 3 equals 6. And those that had disease that extended beyond the prostate also had a higher PIRADS score. And here we can see the accuracy, which was very good. So the final results, 43 of the 81 patients had EPE. 17 of 81 had 3 plus 4 equals 7 after prostatectomy. 2 of the 81 were actually downgraded to a 3 plus 3 equals 6 Gleason score. PIRADS version 2 scores were significantly higher for those that had a Gleason score of 4 plus 3 equals 7 tumors. PI-RADS version 2 scores showed moderate accuracy for the diagnosis of 4 plus 3 equals 7 lesions. Category 4, in terms of PI-RADS or higher, was more sensitive and specific. But no PI-RADS V2 category 3 or lower had a Gleason score of 4 plus 3 equals 7. And so this was very accurate. Most of the errors that occurred in the study were those in which there was a Gleason score of 3 plus 3 equals 6 or 3 plus 4 equals 7 tumors. And as we saw in the graph, the PI-RADS version 2 categories were higher in patients that had a tumor extension beyond the prostate. So here we have a couple examples that are present within the paper. And we can see this patient here who had a T2A tumor, had a PSA of 6.2 and had 3 positive biopsies. And we can see on the fast spin T2 echo as well as the ADC map, we can see the lesion within the left aspect of the prostate. This received a PI-RADS version 2 category 2. This next case was this patient here that had 5 positive biopsies, PSA of 10.7, and the tumor was T1C. And we can see that the tumor is present on T2 trace echo planar as well as ADC. And this patient received a PI-RADS version 2 category of 5 with a tumor size of 18 millimeters. So some of the take-home points for this study. There was a higher assessment category using PI-RADS version 2 that was associated with upgrading of tumors to the Gleason scale of 3 plus 4 equals 7. That extension beyond the prostate following prostatectomy. And the PI-RADS version 2 score of 3 or higher was 100% sensitive for diagnosing lesions with the a Gleason score of 7. So here's the educational article for the GU section that I'll talk about, and this is something that we tend to all see at some point if we're a chest imager or a body imager, and that is lesions within the adrenal glands. And so here is their summary chart that they included within their article, and we can see that it's very detailed, but their approach was to describe the imaging technique and feature on each of these types of imaging studies, including unenhanced CT, multi-phase adrenal washout CT, MRI, including T2 weighting, as well as chemical shift imaging. And they talked about each of these findings with regards to what the pathology was. And they included lipid-poor and lipid-rich adenomas, pheochromocytoma, carcinomas, myelolipoma, as well as metastases. And so we'll see some of the examples that they talked about in their article. Here's a patient who presented with lung cancer and had this nodule that was present within the left adrenal gland on unenhanced CT. And so it was indeterminate because the Hounsfield units were 23. And so they subsequently had a multi-phase adrenal mass protocol CT obtained. And we can see that at the 72nd point following IV contrast injection, that the Hounsfield units were 140. And then at 15 minutes, the Hounsfield units were 5.9. And so the absolute washout was 69.2% relative in the high 50s. So what do you think this was? Adenoma. Contrast that with this patient here who had a PET CT, and we can see that they had this very FDG avid lesion within the right hemithorax, but that they also had this focus that was FDG avid within the right adrenal gland. And so this was concerning for metastasis. So we can see on MRI imaging the end phase, the opposed phase, and the subtraction images. And so we can see that a portion of this is fat because it does lose signal anteriorly, and it is high signal on the subtraction, but that part of it does not lose signal and is low signal intensity on the subtraction. So this patient actually had 2 different lesions within their adrenal gland, and it was actually a metastasis and an adenoma. So this patient had a collision tumor. So some of the take-home points for this study, the unenhanced CT and the chemical shift MR have a very high specificity for lipid-rich adenomas. Dual energy CT can improve detection of lipid-poor adenomas. Lesions that do contain fat that are not adenomas pose a diagnostic dilemma in some cases, but that the multi-phase washout CT can be very helpful. Moving on to nuclear medicine, the first article that I'm going to talk about is this study in which they looked at FDG, PET CT, and CT of patients who underwent hepatectomy for malignancy. So they looked at 149 patients that had both FDG, PET CT, and CT within 1 month of major hepatectomy. And they looked at several imaging calculations preoperatively, including total liver volume, remnant liver volume, the ratio of the remnant liver volume to pre-op volume, and total glycolysis of the remnant liver. In terms of some of the clinical data, they looked at the clinical hepatic function reserve values, the MELD score, as well as the AST to platelet ratio index, or APRI. So here we see some of the images that they analyzed, and we can see this patient here who has this HCC in the right hepatic lobe. That is denoted by the green was actually surgically resected. That's present within the orange was actually the volume that they wanted to look at that would remain. And then we can see their postoperative CT in which they had much of their right hepatic lobe removed. And then we can also look at the PET CT. So the PET CT was obtained preoperatively, and so they wanted to interrogate that region that was going to be the remnant lobe to see, in terms of the SUV max and the SUV mean, if that would also predict patients that would have good liver function. So what they did is they correlated all of this and wanted to see which patients following hepatectomy would have insufficiency and which would not. And so we can see that there were several that were very accurate. We can see that the MELD score and the APRI in terms of the clinical data was pretty accurate. And then in terms of the imaging data, the best was the total glycolysis on the preoperative PET CT. So of the 149 patients, 7 developed hepatic insufficiency. The SUV mean showed the highest sensitivity, but the total glycolysis of the remnant liver showed the highest specificity. And a model including APRI and TLG of the remnant liver had a higher area under the ROC curve than others, including SUV mean, MELD, APRI, and the remnant liver volume. So the take-home points for this study are that the total glycolysis of the remnant liver had moderate sensitivity and high specificity for predicting hepatic insufficiency, and that by combining total glycolysis of the remnant liver and the APRI did yield the best diagnostic performance. The second research article in the Nuke Med section is this article that looked at the utility of PET CT following cryoablation of bone metastases. So we can see here that they looked at 80 bone lesions in 61 patients, and some of these patients had FDG PET CT, and some of them had choline PET. And so what they did is they looked at the pre and the post scans following ablation. And we can see here this is the breakdown of what type of bone metastases these patients had. Most of them had prostate cancer, but some of them had melanoma and others. Here we can see here some of the findings that resulted. We can see that 23, around half of those patients that had 18F FDG PET CT had progression afterwards, and around 35% of those that had a choline PET had progression. And so here we can see some examples. So this patient had a prostate cancer diagnosis and had this metastasis within the sacrum that was very FDG avid. Here we can see the image from their cryoablation. And then we can see their post-therapy PETs. We can see the first one that was 78 days post-ablation, we can still see some FDG uptake within the sacrum. And this only increased at 188 days post-ablation. So this patient did have recurrence in this region. So the take-home point for this study was that the SUV max ratio, meaning the max compared to the blood pool following cryoablation for osseous metastasis, should raise concern about local progression following treatment. The review article that I'm going to talk about is this one, in which they discussed the role of FDG PET CT with regards to lung cancer. And so, as a chest radiologist, this was kind of near and dear to my heart. But some of the features that they do talk about are the diagnosing and staging of lung cancers, as well as trying to evaluate these patients following therapy. So, as we all know, PET CT is superior to PET and CT alone in trying to evaluate most lung cancers in terms of trying to identify them as well as stage them. And that's because most lung cancers are very active on PET CT, and they can be distinguished from less active background and normal structures. And PET CT is very useful in staging and restaging, response to therapy surveillance, and trying to identify patients that have recurrent disease. There are some exceptions to this, which I want to show a few examples of. There are some lung adenocarcinomas that manifest as consolidation, such as this case, that are not very FDG avid. And we can see here that the uptake is very similar to the blood pool. And so this patient was followed and subsequently had growth of this lesion that was biopsied and was an adenocarcinoma. So there are some types of lung cancer that will not be very FDG avid on PET. PET is also very good for identifying lymph nodes that can be involved. So here we had this CT, and this patient had this small lymph node that was present within the lower left neck. And so based on CT size criteria, we wouldn't be too concerned about this normally on CT. But we can see on PET that it was very FDG avid. So this patient did have spread to this lymph node. We're often asked in terms of lymph nodes whether PET is at a place to where it can replace invasive sampling, and the answer is not quite. We're getting better at it, but we're not there yet. And that's because of this example here. So we can see here on the CT that this patient has a left upper lobe lung cancer that's very avid on PET. But we can see that we have a couple of different findings in the mediastinum. We have this lymph node that is enlarged that has the asterisks on it, and we can see that that lymph node is not very avid on PET at all. It's similar to the blood pool. But we do have this new focus that was FDG avid in the left hilar region. Well, this enlarged lymph node that was negative on PET was biopsied and was actually positive, even though the primary was FDG avid and the lymph node was not. And then this lymph node that we didn't see at all on CT was positive on PET. So we can see that there are pros and cons of PET in general. So we can't replace invasive sampling yet. PET is very good at being able to identify sites of disease that we would not be able to predict otherwise. So in this patient here who has several FDG avid lesions that are present within the chest wall, we can see on CT that there's really no correlate for those. So if we had just gotten a CT, we would have missed those. Here we have some examples from the actual article that show this staging study in which this patient had a right hilar mass and spread of disease in the right hemithorax, as well as a metastasis in the left chest wall anteriorly. And then on follow-up study, following chemotherapy, they had complete resolution of uptake within these lesions. So this patient had a very good response. So that was kind of one way that we can look at the qualitative or the semi-quantitative measurement of evaluating response to therapy. But there, some of you may work with PERSIS. That's something that we tend to work with a lot at Anderson. And these are criteria that directly involve the appearance of lesions on PET CT, and we can actually compare them from time point to time point. And PERSIS came about because there are some problems with the MAX SUV in terms of it being somewhat inconsistent based on patient features as well as scanner features. And so it's very hard to apply the SUV MAX from time point to time point if patients have a different body weight or if they have been scanned on a different scanner. So we've started to use this SUL mean point because it's more reliable. So the way that we actually do PERSIS is that we identify up to 5 lesions, up to 2 per organ, that have the greatest FDG uptake. And then we sum those, and then we compare those between time points to see if patients have a response or not. And so here we can see the overall PERSIS criteria. And so just to kind of highlight a few of these, in patients that have a complete metabolic response, they have no lesions that are FDG avid. Those that have a partial response have some change in their peak SUL from their baseline that's either 30% or greater. And so we can see an example here of actually where PERSIS pays off. So this patient here had this FDG avid lung cancer that was present in the right upper lobe. And then following therapy, they had a follow-up PET. And we can see that there's really been no difference in the overall size of the lesion, but that it has decreased in terms of its FDG uptake. So if we were just using RECIST 1.1 and use size criteria, then we would have called this patient stable whenever actually they are improving. So this is one example where PERSIS is very valuable. One of the problems with PERSIS and some of the other semi-quantitative measurements of FDG uptake in lesions is that it's very heterogeneous in terms of most tumors. So, here we have an example of a lesion that is very heterogeneous. And if you were just going to identify the SUV max, the point that's the hottest, in other words, then you could be fooled into thinking this patient had a very active tumor. But if you looked at the remainder of it, you can see that it's much more heterogeneous and there are regions that are not very avid. And so we're starting to look at some more quantitative techniques in terms of FDG PET. And so there have been several volume-based parameters such as the MTV and the TLG that have started to look at this. And several studies with lung cancer, esophageal cancer, and many others have started to see that these are better predictors of prognosis and survival than SUV max. And so here we have an example of how we actually do this. So instead of just identifying the point that's the hottest or the max SUV, we can actually contour the entire lesion, such as this, and get these quantitative measurements. PET is also good for post-therapy. So here we have a patient that had a previous diagnosis of lung cancer and had this FDG avid nodule in the right upper lobe. And then following radiation therapy, they had this PET CT, and we can see that the nodule has responded, but that there's some new opacities in the right lung that are FDG avid. And so this was actually post-radiation change. So finally, PET is very good at being able to tell between recurrence and post-therapy changes, much better than CT. And so we can see this patient here that had this left upper lobe lung cancer that had been previously treated with radiation therapy. We can see two years after treatment, This lesion was not very avid. It had a similar uptake to the blood pool. But that at 36 months, or 3 years after therapy, this was newly FDG avid. And so whenever we correlated that with the CT image, we can actually see that there is subtle volume increase and convexity of this nodule. So this patient did have recurrent disease, but it's much more obvious on a PET CT than on a CT. So the final area that I'll talk about is health policy and quality. And the first article is this article that looked at the non-critical but significant recommendations that had been issued in radiology reports. And they wanted to see how good they were in terms of following them. So what they did is they looked at around 6,851 reports. They found that around 857 reports that had at least one recommendation, or around 13%, were not followed. And so this was a total of 978 total recommendations. And so whenever we break down all these recommendations from the reports, we can see that around two-thirds of these were not followed at all. Around 60% had an explanation for why they were not followed, but around 39% had no explanation at all. And we'll talk about some of these. Here are some of the recommendations that didn't have evidence of follow-up or verbal communication. And we can see that some of these are very significant. Some of these include a lung mass, it was cancer, as well as other lesions. So some of the take-homes from this study are that, you know, even though we do make some recommendations in our imaging reports, they may not always be acknowledged or followed by the ordering providers. Some that are not followed or acknowledged can have significant impact on patients. And in some cases, such as the institution of these authors, it did result in some systems improvement investment. The second article is this one on burnout. And so this is a very hot topic, so I wanted to talk about this one. And in this one, they actually polled residents in the New England area. This is an article that was actually published recently in the New England Journal of Medicine regarding burnout. So this is something that's on most healthcare providers' minds these days. In terms of the study design, they included a 31-item survey that had the Maslach Burnout Inventory Health Services survey. And they surveyed some of the resident members of the New England Society. And this included 20 programs and 472 residents. And they looked at some of these scores that included exhaustion emotionally, depersonalization, and personal accomplishment scores. And they also talked about clinical hours, research hours, and study hours. And so most of the people who responded to the survey indicated that they had 45 or fewer hours that they had to devote to clinical time per week. In terms of study hours, most had 8 or less. And in terms of research hours, we can see that more than two-thirds of them had less than 5 hours that they were able to devote to research efforts. So they had 94 responses of the 472 residents who received the survey. They found that high scores, relatively speaking, were reported. 37% reported emotional exhaustion, 48% depersonalization, and around half of them did not feel that they were accomplished personally. Increasing resident year correlated with high EE as well as DP. Overall, the scores were lower compared to other specialties, which is concerning. The relatively low personal accomplishment score was identified as something by the authors that could be addressed to improve overall feelings of burnout. So the last article that I'm going to talk about is this article, in which they actually looked to see how satisfied patients were with radiologists using several sites online. So the RateMD site was evaluated for patient reviews. Some of the criteria they used is that they looked at 297 cities with population of at least 100,000. And the reviews were scored 1 to 5, 1 being the lowest, 5 being the highest. And several of the features that they looked at were staff, the punctuality, knowledge, and helpfulness. And so we can see that scores were either really positive or really negative, and they tended to be clustered. So even though most patients reported that they were very happy with their care in terms of staff functionality, helpfulness, and knowledge, that there were a significant number who reported that they were very unhappy with their care. So they received 1,891 reviews on around 1,200 radiologists. The most common scores, as we saw, were excellent or 5, or terrible for 1, and they all correlated very highly with each other. Whenever we look at region, there was actually a trend towards lower scores for the Northeast for a few regions such as staff and punctuality. And then whenever they asked patients to write down what the, some of their comments about their overall care, these were the ones that popped up most frequently. They were most concerned about time as well as staff. In terms of the positive statements they made, they included that the staff were caring, that they were knowledgeable and professional. And those that were negative talked about a rude experience, pain, and staff that were unprofessional. So the take-home points for this study are that most radiologists scored well, but they tended to be very strongly positive or very strongly negative, and that there are several factors that we need to consider whenever patients give these reviews, and they include both facility and radiologist factors. So thank you very much. If you have any questions, please feel free to send me an email or tag me on Twitter. Thank you.